I'm excited. I'd like for us to open our Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 15 to begin with. The story is told about the baptism of King Angus by St. Patrick in the middle of the 5th century. Sometime during the rite, St. Patrick leaned on his staff and moved his staff and accidentally stabbed the king's foot. After the baptism was over, St. Patrick looked down and he saw the blood and he realized what he had done. He apologized to the king and he says, "Why did you suffer this pain in silence?" And the king responded, "I thought it was part of the ritual." You know, we can misunderstand things, and I think baptism is a misunderstood rite. There are many things about it that we don't understand, maybe a non-Christian for sure, and even among believers, there are misconceptions and ideas about baptism that I'd like for us to address. But first of all, I'd like for us to look at 1 Corinthians 15, because it declares what the gospel is so clearly. You know, as Christians, we don't have to argue about, well, the gospel to me is, well, the gospel to me is, well, I think the gospel, we don't have to do that because it's defined for us right here. Look at verse 1. He says, "Now I make known to you, brethren," what? The what? Gospel. Let's say it again. The gospel, which I preached to you, which also you received, in which you also stand, and by which you are saved, if you hold fast to the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. And here's the gospel. Three things. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ, what? Died for our sins, that it was buried, and the, what? Rose from the dead the third day. And so that's the gospel. The death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. That's what saves us, is the gospel. Now, the reason believers are baptized in Jesus is because baptism testifies to something. It testifies to the fact that we believe that Jesus really did die, that Jesus really was buried, and that Jesus really rose from the dead. And we unite ourselves in that truth. Now, look at Romans chapter 6, which would be to the left. In Romans chapter 6, the Apostle Paul is writing about how we are dead to sin, but he uses the analogy of baptism. And again, it's not his main point, but as part of his discussion, it comes up. And look what he says in verse 4. Well, 3. "Or do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore, having been buried with him through baptism into death, in order that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of Father, so we too might walk in newness of life." So he is definitely saying, look at the analogy between the death and burial and resurrection of Jesus and your baptism. He's writing the Romans. He says, now, that's what our baptism was all about. So by being baptized, we show I'm not just saying that I believe in what Jesus did for me. I'm willing to act on my words. Now, at the end of Matthew, for a lot of us, we'll remember what he said. In the end of Matthew, Jesus gave his disciples orders, and they were marching orders. And the orders were this. He said, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations." Now, he didn't say, "Please go out and do this for me." This is a command. Go out there, he says, make disciples of all the nation, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all the things that I've commanded you. And so baptism, though it doesn't save us, it is an act of obedience. I mean, that's one of the first things Jesus said. Well, it is for his disciples to go out and do. He says, make disciples, get them saved. I know it's the power of the Holy Spirit and all. But you go, you preach, you present. Got the wrong pro. It's a pre. You go present the gospel. And then when they believe you, what? What follows? Baptize them. So in the book of Acts, we see that whenever somebody was converted, they were baptized. They were always baptized. Acts 8 tells us about the time when Philip went to Samaria and he preached the gospel. And it says, but when they believed Philip preaching the good news about the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus, they were being baptized, men and women alike. In Acts 10, when Cornelius had been praying, you know, God, you know, just send me more light. I need to know more of you. Peter had the vision. He sent to Caesarea on the Mediterranean. And the household of Cornelius, these Gentiles, believed. The Holy Spirit came upon them just like he did on the day of Pentecost for the Jews. And they believed and they were baptized right away. In Acts 16, when you remember the Philippian jailer, I mean, I'm counting that some of you know these New Testament stories. If you don't, you can catch up. Read the book of Acts. But in Acts 16, here the Philippian jailer is crying out to Paul, what must I do to be saved? And he says, well, believe, and be baptized. Believe in Jesus and be baptized. It wasn't meaning that baptism saves, but upon your belief, be baptized. Now look at 1 Corinthians. Don't look there. Go to Acts first. I'm sorry. Go to Acts. Acts chapter 8. This is probably the best example of baptism in the New Testament, maybe in the whole Bible, describing what baptism is all about and gives us a detailed account of baptism. Acts chapter 8, verse 26. Philip was an evangelist. He was also one of those first deacons that was appointed by the apostles in the Jerusalem church. And so he went on to become an evangelist. And there had been a great outpouring of the Lord. Then the Lord spoke to him and he says, the angel of the Lord spoke to him in verse 26, and he said, get up and go south to the road that descends from Jerusalem to Gaza. And this is a desert road. So he went up, got up and went, and there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all her treasure. And he had come to Jerusalem to worship. We'll just pause it for a second. So here is Philip left obediently, went out to the desert. Just happened to be that here is this chariot, a very high official in Queen Candace's court, is going back from Jerusalem. He had come to worship the Lord as a Gentile. The closest he could have gotten was the court of the Gentiles. And that court had been cleansed by Jesus twice and because it had become a commercial place where they were selling animals and sacrifices and who knows what else. And so you couldn't worship there as a Gentile. It was just crazy. So he had gone back, disappointed, I'm sure, and didn't find what he was looking for. And so the Spirit of the Lord in his grace had Philip intersect with him. And the Lord said, run up to his chariot. Well, that had to be kind of intimidating, don't you think? A little bit. Run up to the chariot. I don't even know this person. So he ran up the chariot, and he noticed that he was reading from the scroll of the prophet Isaiah. Now, even having a scroll, it's not like they had the pocket Bibles like we do. You have to understand that they cost an enormous amount. You in your lifetime could probably not work and earn enough money to buy a scroll of the scripture. And so he's very wealthy, has a scroll, and it just happens that Philip hears him reading, and Philip says, do you understand what you're reading? And he says, well, how could I understand unless somebody guides me? And then he says, he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. In verse 32, it just so happens that he's reading from Isaiah 53, and not only that, it just so happens that he's reading one of the most important messianic prophecies there in that chapter. And the scripture was this: he was led to slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he doesn't open his mouth. In humiliation and judgment, he was taken away. Who will relate his generation? For his life is removed from the earth. The eunuch answered Philip, and he said, "Please tell me, of whom does this prophet say this? Of himself or someone else?" Then Philip opened his mouth, and from the beginning from this and all the scripture, he preached Jesus to him. That had to be one of those awesome Bible studies where he started from Genesis and he goes all the way through the Old Testament to the very last promise in Malachi. And then he tells him about the life of Jesus. "I saw Jesus, he's alive," and the Ethiopian believes. And as they went along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, water! What prevents me from being baptized?" And verse 38, it says, he ordered the chariot to stop, and they both went down into the water, Philip as well as the eunuch, and he baptized him. What excitement! I mean, I see three things here. First of all, I see the Ethiopian heard the gospel and had it explained to him. Very clearly, Philip explained and taught the gospel and showed him who Jesus was, and his heart was transformed. And secondly, he believed. So he heard the gospel, he believed, and then upon believing, he was baptized, and he was baptized immediately. It wasn't like, well, 5 years from now, oh, there's water, I'll be baptized. Instead, he believed. Philip must have told him, yeah, and Jesus said, I'm to preach and make disciples and baptize them in the name. So, you know, you want to be baptized as soon as you can. And he's like, there's water, let's go. And they went down into the water and he was baptized. Now, I want to look at several common misunderstandings about baptism. The first is that the rite of baptism somehow saves a person. The rite of baptism somehow saves a person. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, which would be to the right from where we are in Acts. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, the Apostle Paul shares what his agenda was when he went to Corinth. And it wasn't anything other than to preach Jesus. Look at what he says. He says in verse 13, there's some division going on, and he directly confronts that, and he says, look, what is this division? Were you baptized in this person's name? Were you baptized in my name? No. You know, it's all about Christ. And he says in verse 14, I thank God I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, that no man should say that you were baptized in my name. And then it's like, it says, oh yeah, I did baptize also the house of Stephanas. Beyond that, I don't know whether I baptized any other. For, look at 17, for Christ did what? Not send me to what? Baptize, but to preach the gospel. Not in cleverness of speech, that the cross of Christ should not be made void. Now, if baptism somehow saved a person, how could Paul say, I didn't come to baptize, but to preach the gospel? Couldn't you misunderstand that? Hello? Do you understand where I'm coming from? Instead, he says, I didn't come to baptize. I came to preach the gospel. And then upon the gospel, believing in the gospel, then what? People are baptized. But baptism is not part of the gospel. It's not the death, the burial, and resurrection, Jesus, and baptism. There's not 4 points to the gospel. We're saved by the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus alone. And baptism is a deed of righteousness that we should do. It's the right thing to do, but right things don't save us. The second misunderstanding is that infants should be baptized. Now, I want to tread carefully here, but I don't want to offend anybody, but the Bible says that all of these people we've looked at in the book of Acts, I've referred to, they all believed and were baptized, believed and were baptized, believed and were baptized. There is no example in our Bibles of anybody who could not believe being baptized. And so those who were baptized were always able to be cognizant of what they were doing. They were mature enough to understand what baptism meant. Okay, so believers are to be baptized, not infants. So why do we think infants need to be baptized? Why is that a thought? Well, let me tell you. It's a thought because of the first error. The first error is thinking that baptism, what? Saves you. So if baptism saves you, I got to make sure I'm baptized before I die, at least at my deathbed, you know. And if baptism saves me, what if there's a high infant mortality rate like there was in the ancient world? What if my baby dies and isn't baptized? What happens to my baby? So I better baptize my baby. Well, see, we're not saved by baptism. A baby, a child wouldn't be saved by baptism. In fact, the Bible says something really sweet about children and salvation. I'm going to read from Matthew chapter 18, and I would love you to look at verses 10 and 11 and verse 14. Matthew 18, verses 10 and 11 and 14. Speaking of little children, listen to what Jesus said. See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I say to you that their angels in heaven continually behold the face of my Father who is in heaven. And then this parenthesis in verse 11. Now, we know that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost, right? But specifically, in the context of little children, Jesus says, for the Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost. In other words, specifically, Jesus says it again in this context, and he says, you know these little kids who can't believe, these little ones, I want you to know that I specifically came to seek and to save them. And then he goes on to say, thus, in verse 14, it is not the will of your Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones, what? Perish. All the children, they belong to Jesus. All the babies who have died, they're in heaven with the Lord. All the little babies who have been aborted, they're in heaven with the Lord. Children who are too young to understand the gospel, irregardless, they're at home with the Lord because the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. Amen? And so a child does not have to be baptized in order to be saved. So if your parents baptized you, had you baptized as a baby, do you see what a loving thing it was they did for you? They loved you so much they didn't want you to be lost. But you realize, I didn't have to be baptized because I couldn't believe, for one thing. Now the third misunderstanding is that baptism, how the mode of baptism, how is a person baptized? The Greek word for baptism means to immerse, to saturate. It was a term that was used by dyers. People were given the cloth and they said, we want purple cloth. So we'd take it to a vat of purple dye and they would take the cloth and they would immerse the cloth into the dye. Isn't that the way you dye the cloth? They would baptizo it, and we get our word baptism from it. They would immerse that, baptizo it, and then they would bring it up, and it would be saturated with the dye. No other way for that to happen. When Jesus took the piece of bread on the Passover, and he gave it to Judas, it says, first of all, he dipped the bread into the wine, and then he gave it to Judas. He baptizo it. He dipped it down. Jews understood what baptism was because they practiced the ceremonial washings, and that wasn't going to the shower like this. They would go to a mikvah, it's called, a little baptistry, and they would immerse themselves, go all the way under the water, come all the way up, and he had the idea of, of the water was death. Going under the water meant you died. Coming up out of the water meant that you were a new person and you had a new life. It said, as we read in Acts 8, that Philip went down into the water with the Ethiopian when he was baptized, and they came back out of the water. There's water. They went down into it. They were dipped under. He was dipped under the water, and he came up out of the water. So, 3 points. Baptism declares our union with Christ. It's a dramatic picture of me being united with Christ. It says, I believe I'm saved by Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. See, baptism doesn't save you. You're not a new person as soon as you come out of the water. That's a common misunderstanding. When I was baptized the first time, I wasn't baptized understanding the gospel. I wasn't even baptized by a Christian church. When I was baptized, though, I had the idea, I was led to believe that when I baptized and went under the water, I came up and I was a new person. It's a really common misunderstanding. And so my brother and I would fight. We fought like cats and dogs. I was 4 years older, wiser, smarter. And we would like knock heads all the time. And so I thought, man, I'm going to be baptized. All this bad is going to be buried because I'd hear these terms. I'm going to come up a new person and it'll be all clean and perfect. And so I was baptized. I came up a new person, all clean and perfect, got into the car, going home. And my brother started this thing, I started my thing, and already my clean and perfectness was gone. Let me tell you this. You're already clean and perfect in Jesus before you get into the water, amen? Amen. That water, going under the water doesn't mean you come up. We're so mistaken there. It's not you come up, I'm coming up a new person. No, you're a new person before you were baptized. The Bible says if any person is in Christ, he's a new creation. At that moment you believe in Jesus, behold, everything becomes new. When you come into Jesus, when you're saved, baptism is just a picture of what already has happened. Say already has happened. Already has happened. It's a picture of that. But you don't say, well, it's only a picture. No, it's something that Jesus said, I command you to do. I don't suggest you, I command you to do. Secondly, leading right into that, it is a picture of our obedience to Christ. Though baptism isn't a matter of salvation, it is a matter of obedience. And I have to underline that. It is a matter of obedience. The Lord Jesus commanded it. Go into the world, preach the gospel, make disciples, baptize them. Wasn't a suggestion, it was a command. If we love the Lord, we will obey him. Oh, there you go with the guilt trip. No, that's not a guilt trip, it's fact. If you love the Lord, you will obey him. In fact, Jesus clearly suggests that if you love him, you'll do what he says. Look at John chapter 14, verse 15. John chapter 14, verse 15. And I bet you already many of us know the verse, but we're going to read it anyway, good and loud. It's just one short sentence, but it's essential to our life as disciples of Jesus. It says, read it out loud with me. If you what? Love me, you'll keep my commandments. One more time. If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. The commandments of Jesus are his teachings. And 1 John 2:3 says, and by this we know that we have come to know him, if we keep his commandments. What is the evidence that I know the Lord? I keep his commandments. In Luke, Jesus said, why do you keep calling me Lord, Lord, when you don't do what I say? If you love me, keep my commandments. It's a sign of our union with Christ. It's a sign of our obedience to Christ. And it's our sign of loyalty and commitment to Christ. We're not just content with believing in our hearts. We want to go public. Jesus said, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do what I say?" You see, baptism is the next step after salvation of showing our love and obedience and loyalty to Him. You'll note that throughout the Bible, throughout the book of Acts especially, there's a sequence of hearing, believing, being baptized. Hearing, believing, being baptized. That's the biblical pattern. Everybody's repented from their sins, accepts the Lord, and then they are eligible to be baptized. Some of us have missed a step. We're enjoying Bible study, fellowship, we're enjoying all of these things, but we've forgotten the step. We need to be baptized. Does baptism save me? No. But baptism is a symbol of my union with Christ, my obedience to Christ, and my loyalty to Christ. I think most believers are not yet baptized because one of four reasons. Thought this through, and I think there are probably four reasons. The first is maybe you haven't been baptized because of fear. You could be afraid of what people think. It could be family. You could be your tradition that, you know, if you get baptized, you know that's going to sever you from some ties in your family. That happens. It happens around the world when people are baptized. In many places in the world, you're really not considered a Christian by your family or anybody else until you're baptized. At that point, oop, you're really serious, and then people reject you. Or you're persecuted. It's the baptism of Christians in Iran and Iraq and other Muslim countries that are so opposed to the gospel. It's once you're baptized, okay, now, because it shows obedience and loyalty to Christ. And we take it so lightly. Maybe there's fear of water, believe it or not. Some people are afraid of the water. But I'll tell you, never lost anybody. Nobody's gone downstream. It's kind of contained where we baptize. We don't do the river thing. I'd love to, but we could say, look, there's no water. But we got water. We've got these nice little contained hot tubbish things. And usually they're warm, believe it or not. I think they ought to be cold. You remember it better. I remember one guy, an older guy. Oh, I shouldn't tell you. Oh, well. So it's fear. Many times it's fear. Sometimes it's a lack of understanding. Like I'm saying, well, I was baptized as a baby. Again, very gently here. You weren't baptized, okay? You weren't baptized because real baptism, you have to believe and understand, correct? You got that nailed down. Secondly, what's the mode of baptism? It's baptism by immersion. It's not sprinkling. Sprinkling, pouring, it's an abbreviation for baptism, but it doesn't show the picture of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. And I suppose in some extreme situations, if that's all the water you have, okay, God understands. But you know, when we're talking about the opportunity to be baptized as Jesus was, as John baptized, as New Testament baptized people then, you know, we take advantage of that. And so baptized as a child, to be baptized as a child wasn't really to be baptized, though, like I said, your parents loved you so much that they wanted you to be baptized. But now as an adult, it's your time to be baptized scripturally. Maybe you didn't understand baptism. I think another thing besides fear and lack of understanding could be a lack of opportunity. Okay, well, I'd love to be baptized, but when? Where? You know, should I baptize myself? I've known some people who have baptized themselves. There was nobody to do it. And they wanted to be baptized, so they baptized themselves. I guess that's okay. But it could be a cop-out for any of us, you know? We want to make a public confession of Christ. We want to have an opportunity before the body of Christ to say, I'm not ashamed of my Savior. When's the opportunity? Well, there's an opportunity today. I mean, we have water. There's water. I could be Philip right now. Look. Or the Ethiopian. Look, there's water. What would prevent me from being baptized? And I'd have to say what? Nothing. There's water. Well, I didn't come prepared. I mean, I'd really like to. Well, we have whatever I think you'd need. We have things, clothes for you to change into, modest clothes. We have a nice place for you to change. We have water. We have towels. Let's see. Don't think we have the blower dryers, ladies, but, my hair will get messed up. You know, I go back to Jesus. I think, you know, what did he suffer for me? He wore a crown of thorns. Forget his hair. You know what I mean? Forget it. This is about you and Jesus and obedience to Christ. And I think the fourth problem is people are just procrastinators. Oh, I'll put it off. I'll put it off. Not now. Not now. I've got a lunch appointment. I've got whatever. You know what? Why don't we step in and say, Jesus is more important than other things, and say, you know what? Lord, you mean more to me than anything. More than my soccer game, more than my whatever. God, I'm going to actually stand and say, I want to follow you and obey your command. That's why we're following Jesus. Here's a section from the book Follow Me by David Platt. The significance of baptism was etched into my mind and heart during my time with Asian brothers and sisters in underground house churches. I was teaching one day from Matthew 28 on making disciples, and I explained Jesus' command for Christians to be baptized. I emphasized how baptism is a critical, essential, and non-negotiable step of obedience for a new follower of Christ, because it symbolizes his or her fundamental identification with the death and resurrection of Jesus. After I finished, two of the men in the room, Lee and Huan, shared that they had not yet been baptized and they wanted to be. So the next day, one of the pastors in this church, house church, Jing, asked me to do some more extensive teaching on baptism. As I talked through passages like Romans 6, it suddenly hit me. I was sitting in a country where it was illegal for these two men to identify themselves as followers of Christ through baptism. This was a decisive turning point in their lives and potentially dangerous decision for them to make. Humbled by this realization, I closed our time in the Word with a reminder to Lee and Huan that it could cost them greatly to be baptized that day. Immediately, Jing asked Lee and Huan to come to the middle of the room. Everyone sat silently as Lee and Huan took their stand. Jing looked at Lee, a brother in his mid-20s, who had recently come to faith in Christ, and asked him point blank, Lee, are you willing to be baptized, knowing that it may cost you your life? And with unhesitating resolve, Lee looked back at Jing and he said, I have already sacrificed everything to follow Jesus. Yes, I want to be baptized. Huan was a teenager who had also recently come to faith in Christ. In front of the rest of the house church, Jing asked him, Huan, are you willing to be baptized today, knowing that it may cost you your life? And with a slight quiver in his voice, Huan looked back at Jing and he said, Jesus is my Lord. Whatever he says, I will do. With that, Lee and Huan were baptized at the risk of their lives. As I watched these brothers identify with Christ through baptism, I knew that from this point forward, both of their futures would be completely different. They had given everything they were, everything they had, everything they would ever do, and they would everything they could ever be to Jesus. They had completely and gladly surrendered their ways to God's will. Lord, we desire to be people who live in a cushy society, to follow your will. For none of us would being baptized be this kind of a cost today. Lord, it's a matter of us following your will here in a culture where we're safe at this point. I thank you for the many, 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 many people who've already decided to follow you in baptism. They've already decided to take that step of identification and obedience to their Lord. And Lord, I pray for those that you are moving on right now, and the Spirit's just saying, come, do what's right. May they do so with joy, Lord, without hesitation, is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.